What's up, everyone? Sam here from bitebybite.com, and today I want to tell you about the 5 string patterns that you absolutely have to know to master string interview questions. Plus, if you stick around to the end, I'm going to share with you the one mistake that I see people making time and time again when they are doing string interview questions. All right. Let's get into the meat of this. But before we actually get into what the 5 patterns are, I want to tell you something that's really important. And that is that there's a reason why I'm teaching you these 5 patterns and I'm not focusing on telling you everything there is to possibly know about strings. And that reason is simply that for most topics, you don't need to know everything about the topic. It's much more important that you understand the fundamentals and the core patterns than understand everything. So if you understand what we talk about in this video, that's going to get you about 80% of the way there. And then you can supplement with additional information as needed, but this is going to give you a really good starting point. And if you enjoy what you're seeing in this video, we also have a blog post that covers this and a lot more in a lot more detail. So you can click that in the description below or go to bitebybite.com/strings and you will find that. So let's get into the 5 patterns. The very first pattern that you want to use a lot when you're interviewing and doing string problems is using a length 256 integer array to represent character counts or to basically track characters in a string. And so if you think about it, a simple example of this would be if we wanted to find all the anagrams or if we wanted to find if 2 strings were anagrams. An anagram is basically 2 strings that have the same characters, but they're in a different order. And so one way that we could do that would be to count all the characters. And the obvious way to do that might be to use a hash table, right? We could create a hash table and we would basically just map character to count of the number of occurrences of that character. And then we could compare both strings. And so that would work. But another way that we can do this, and we can do this because we have a fixed number of characters, whether it's 256 in the case of ASCII, or if we were using Unicode, we would have some larger set, but we have a fixed size number of characters that we could use, and we can create an integer array and basically use the character as the index and the counts as the value in that array. And so what we would do is we would create that array and then we would look up, you know, for if a letter is like the integer value 53 or something, we would look that up as the index of our array and then we would look up the character count. And so this is a really good strategy that we can use in a lot of cases because using an array has way less overhead than using a hash table. And especially if we have a lot of characters, it's going to just make our lives a lot easier to work with that. The second pattern that you should absolutely be aware of is using 2 pointers in a string. And this is something that you may have come across if you've been doing any linked list problems, but it's very similar in a string where we might use 2 different pointers to accomplish something in our string. The perfect example of this is if we wanted to reverse a string. Now, imagine that maybe a better example would be if we wanted to reverse like an array. What we can do is we can have pointers at either end and we can walk those pointers towards each other and basically just swap the values at those pointers. And by doing that, by using those 2 pointers, we can accomplish the exact same thing that we would accomplish otherwise, but it's going to be a lot easier for us. And there are a lot of different examples of how you might use multiple pointers. So like if you wanted to find all the duplicates in a string without using any extra space, that's an easy way to do it. And a lot of other things that I talk about in the blog post. The next pattern that you should be aware of is just generally how to do string math and how to convert between like characters and integers and all this sort of fun stuff. It's something that ends up being kind of a pain in a lot of languages because it's just there can be a lot of complexity or a lot of confusion over when a character is handled as a character versus an integer versus a byte versus any of these different data types. And so the key thing here is just to understand how your chosen programming language is going to treat that. And so like as we were talking about using a length 256 array, you need to actually be able to take that character and convert it into its ASCII value, right? So that's something that we're going to need to be able to do easily. And one potential way that we can do that in a lot of languages is you could just subtract characters. So for example, if you wanted to figure out what was the index of a character in the alphabet, you could take that character and you could subtract capital A from that character, and it would give you the index. So understanding these sorts of little tricks is really valuable, and also being able to do things like convert a digit character into the actual digit. So like if we wanted to convert between a string number and the actual integer value, we would need to be able to get the values of those digits. And so understanding this sort of thing in your strings is really valuable. The next thing, the fourth pattern that we want to understand, is generally doing string comparison and alignment and matching. And this is something that comes up a lot, and this is going to be similar to our two pointers, except that now we actually have two different strings. And so in most of these cases, we're going to have a pointer into each string, and we're going to use those to sort of line up the strings and compare them. And so some examples of problems that might involve this pattern are going to be the longest common substring problem, the edit distance problem, anything where we're comparing two strings and trying to find what are the similarities between them. You're also, when you get to this point, you're going to be drawing on a lot of recursion stuff as well, which tends to make it a lot more difficult. And so you're definitely going to want to check out the post that we wrote, and I'll put this in the description as well, this post that we recently published on recursion, which you can get to at bytebybyte.com/recursion. It's going to give you a lot more in-depth look at how you can use recursion with these string problems and also a lot of other things. Finally, the last pattern that I want to talk about, and I want to make sure that we're all on the same page with this, is just string algorithms in general. So there are algorithms that you've probably heard of, like Knuth Morris Pratt, there's Boyer Moore, there's Rabin Karp, and there are a bunch of other algorithms that maybe it would be good to know, right? And the key thing here is that whenever you are studying like these named algorithms, you really want to focus more on what is the underlying strategy here, what are the underlying techniques that I can learn from, rather than trying to actually memorize the entire algorithm. And that's just because it's very unlikely that you would actually be asked to like implement Boyer Moore, for example, in your interview. However, by studying these algorithms, you can learn what were the strategies that these people use in these algorithms, and what are there additional patterns, or are there little things that I can learn from and that I could apply to other sorts of problems. So when you're thinking about these string algorithms, don't worry so much about, do I remember the exact algorithm? Do I remember the name of the algorithm? But focus much more on, do I understand the concepts and can I apply those concepts? So those are the five patterns that you need to know. Using a length 256 array, using two pointers, doing string math, string comparison, and string algorithms. And now I promised you that I would tell you the biggest mistake that I see people making with strings. And the number one mistake that you need to be really careful about is time complexity. And the reason for this is that strings are different than most of the other data types that we work with, or most of the other simple data types we work with. Like, we're used to working with integers and longs and characters and floats and all these things, and those are all fixed size data types, right? Like, obviously there may be different implementations that are a different size, but for the most part, we know what size they are. But with strings, a string can be any number of characters. A string is functionally much more like an array than it is like a primitive data type. And therefore, we need to be really careful about how that affects our time complexity, because things that might seem simple or that are normally going to take constant time can actually take longer. So let's think about an example of this. Like, a very simple example of this would be just comparing two strings together. Now, we're used to, with integers or with floats, that taking constant time, right? Comparing two values, it just takes constant time. But with a string, we actually have to go through and compare all the characters, which is going to mean that all of a sudden our very simple operation is taking linear time and not constant time. And we may not notice that, or that may not be obvious, because we're just using this simple function that we're used to treating as being a constant time function. Another perfect example of that is using strings as keys in a hash table. And if you think about it, when we are putting something into a hash table, we have to take the value and we have to hash it. And how long does it take to hash a string? Well, again, we're used to treating hash tables as this O of one time lookup, but in most cases, if we want to come up with a good hashing algorithm, we're actually going to have to go through the full length of the string. And so this is another example where we think logically, based on our past experience, that it's going to take constant time, but it actually takes linear time. And so the key thing when you're doing string problems is to be super, super careful that you are actually making sure that you are accounting for any extra time complexity that you're using. So that's all I got for you today. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, please give us a subscribe down below. And I also would love for you to check out our free guide on 51 questions that you are most likely to get asked in your interview. So if you go over, you can download that now and get those questions. There are video responses to each one of them. I know you're going to enjoy that. And I appreciate you joining me today. And I look forward to talking to you again soon.